Welcome everyone. Can everyone hear me okay? I'm getting over a cold, so it's hard to get down, but okay. My name is Deborah Keisch. I'm a member of the Northampton Public Schools Action Coalition. There are several of us here. I think some of us took the PSAC on our name tag, so we have questions for other organizations to identify us. We are co-sponsoring this event tonight with the Northampton Human Rights Commission. I'm not sure if anyone here has done that group, but they were established by the City Council in 1998 to advocate for the civil rights of all residents and visitors of the city. They have also come out in opposition to policy testing. And we're very excited about this opportunity tonight to engage with discussion about high stakes testing. PSAC has taken a position opposed to high stakes testing. We kind of want to expose that right up front. The viewpoints that we are presenting are critiques about the impact of high stakes testing on our teachers and our students and on our schools. But we know that not everyone shares those views, and we hope that after the panel, when we go to get in the small groups, we'll be able to engage those conversations and maybe engage questions and things about that. We chose also to present critique in a way that was not neutral at all. We feel like the other side, the pro high stakes testing side, is very well documented, very well stated, and we all know what that side looks like. And so we didn't feel it necessary to kind of be neutral at all. And so the agenda review for this evening, we have the panel, and our panel will speak for about 10 minutes each. Then we'll have about a half hour, 25 minutes to move into roundtable discussions. And we hope to kind of generate some questions during those roundtable discussions that we can bring back to an open big group Q&A with the panelists at the very end of the evening. And then we'll talk a little bit about action steps and things that we can do coming out of this meeting. And so I wanted to say that one of our panelists, Dawn Agna, was called out of the state on a family issue tonight, so she cannot be here. After these three panelists speak, we are going to have a teacher from our school that is going to read something on the public so we have sitting here with us, thank you so much, all three of you for coming, Tim Scott, who is an education activist from the Massachusetts board of directors of the Massachusetts Teachers Association. We have Kristy Holder, who is a National Board Certified Teacher and has a public special education. And we have Beth Malice, who is the president of the Holyoke Teachers Association and the founder of a group called Taking It Back. And so they'll talk more about their vantage points and positions, but they're all just going to speak to the impacts from their particular viewpoint experiences.
So, I'm going to start by providing some context, historical context, as well as the groundwork of every form and how it fits into it. I may read a bit here, and I'm going to start by reading a piece from the open note. So, starting this, decades ago, a scathing critique of American education was published, claiming that American schooling was in a dismal state, putting the nation's future at risk. Within that critique, proposals for curriculum reform were introduced that would better prepare students to enter the workforce while at the same time addressing grade short of skill level. In this curriculum, classroom achievement standards were specified in advance, planning according to a series of distinct steps, each of which entailed specifying numerous definite and detailed curriculum objectives and outcomes. It's often claimed that scientific analysis alone would reveal what is required of students, teachers, and schools, allowing schools to abandon curriculum activities that were not directly relevant to modern workforce development. Also, teacher competence or efficiency would be measured in relation to the number of students who met those clearly defined standards. The results of one school could be compared with others in order to establish an index of relative school efficiency. Do you want to guess what year that came out? Actually, what I've just read is summarized comes directly from the writings of Joseph Rice and John Franklin Bobbitt in the year 1912. So we're going back. They were prominent designers and leaders of movements towards standardization and outcomes-based education, during that era, which were key components of what's called the social efficiency movement and the scientific movement of education, which were part of and directly influenced by Frederick Winslow Taylor in the seminal 1911 book, Principles of Scientific Management, which laid down the fundamental principles of large-scale manufacturing through assembly manufacturing. So there's a link going back decades, and from that point forward, for the decades to follow, that established our public schools and the purpose of schooling. I think it's always important for us to recognize that education systems in all societies are designed to serve as the primary institutions that reproduce dominant norms, dominant social and economic orders, customs and belief systems. And this actuality has always been the case with U.S. public education, thus making schooling a function of capitalism and its intrinsic restraints on democracy and social equality, which, as many of us know, is based on race, class, ability, and other institutional oppressions. With this in mind, throughout the 20th century, public education's purpose, to various degrees, also considering geographic norms and customs differences, has reflected tensions between conservative and progressive social, economic, and political forces and movements within our larger society. So, from there on, there were shifts, and there were many reform efforts, reform public education that mirrored movements that were going on in larger society. So going forward, 70 years after this first alarmist call for standardized schooling that primarily serves private industry, another such report was released entitled "The Nation's Risk: The Imperative for Education," which some of you were talking about. And that was released in 1983, and this time by the free market ideologues within the Reagan administration. And the Nation at Risk marked the emergence of what we now refer to as corporate education reform, and was a significant part for broader free market resurgence and restructuring of our societal priorities over the next 30 years up to now. And so this restructuring entails regressive tax policy, deregulation of industry, free trade agreements, elimination of public services and social safety nets, including systematic defunding of public education. A Nation at Risk set in motion an ideological and structural framework for market-based education reforms that have driven institution policy over the past 30 years. Using the now familiar discourse of crisis and urgency, A Nation at Risk declared that the state of U.S. public education poses a threat to the nation's economic survival and national security. So, great crisis, the principles of the shock doctrine built in. In line with early 20th century prescriptions, A Nation at Risk outlined ways public schools should operationalize corporate prescribed aptitudes for the nation's workforce and citizenship through predefined growth learning outcomes with content and achievement standards that are quantitatively measured and advance the worldview defined by free market. It proposed implementing national systems of accountability through a common core curriculum and standardized assessments. This is 1983. Leading up to A Nation at Risk in 1983, during a major recession and building upon the momentum of the corporate-sponsored Back to Basics movement of the 1970s, which called for a return to a strict social efficiency model of schooling. Back to Basics and A Nation at Risk was a response to progressive education reforms that had occurred over the previous 70 years, yet more specifically, the social and cultural shifts resulting from the civil rights movement, women's movement, anti-war, and new left movements of the 1960s and 70s. During this period, many aspects of traditional education were being disrupted and reconsidered to various degrees, resulting in more child-centered curriculum and pedagogy, and the inclusion of ethnic studies, revisionist histories, and democratic models for education. education inequities were also being addressed legislatively and legally, resulting in education desegregation, affirmative action, and Head Start programs, leading to a shrinking achievement gap for Black high school students during the 1970s and 80s. You know what's happened with that since. The call for Back to Basics was not just an effort to return to the scientific management model of education, otherwise known as Taylorism, prioritizing the three R's. It was also an effort to ensure that education became a foundational institution in a larger free market insurgency. With the successive promotion of free market initiatives as common sense solutions, each subsequent presidential administration education policy agenda has since centered on market-based policy initiatives. That leads us to from the Reagan administration to Bush 1, we had American 2000, Excellence in Education Act, was not successful, but it was picked up by the Clinton administration with Goals 2000, Education American Act, including American Schools Act, which were the initial attempts to reinvent the nation's K-12 public education system, following the description set by the nation's system. And it's set to meet the needs of a new economy. That's a quote. Through nationalizing the fast developing instruments of corporate education reform. And those policies started to outline at a federal level. School choice, standards-based testing, narrow curriculum, core curriculum, data gathering, accountability, controls, and privatization via charter schools. Bush 2's, George Bush's 2002 No Child Left Behind Act, which was a bipartisan effort, because at that point, after Clinton, the Democratic Party, which often referred to as New Democrats or the Third Way Democrats, adopted free market principles in how they saw domestic policy, as well as how they became more hawkish in foreign policy. But this effort to No Child Behind considered to be the most significant outcomes of market-based education legislation today. It opposed federally mandated content and achievement standards for compulsory testing, attached to systems of sanctions, punitive sanctions against public schools that streamlined the process of public school privatization. It also ushered in highly profitable new market segments in test development and preparation, as well as data gathering analysis and management, whereby corporate vendors design the systems through which districts identify underperforming students, then offer products and services to analyze raw test scores and develop computer-based information systems. Lots of money being made since much I left behind. Before that, but this is really kind of where it started, what really kind of grew. So while income and social inequality has steadily increased over the past few decades, the marketing and public relations that company corporations performs have constructed a discourse of social justice and economic opportunity. So they honed their advertising and marketing to say that this is going to basically address the long-standing education act inequities. But at the same time, selling what's widely known as undemocratic and punitive policies that by design exacerbate existing social inequities. So despite growing national opposition to standardized testing and the expansion of charter schools, the Obama administration circumvented Congress and public debate and implemented the 2009 Race to the Top funding initiative, which doubled down on many of the more contested corporatizing aspects of the left behind. Portrayed as a stimulus package, but in actuality, many very smart people think is a bribery scheme organized along the lines of the International Monetary Fund's structural adjustment programs, whereby resource-starved states are set up to compete for federal education money conditioned on extensive directives to restructure public education into privatized and profit-driven services. Race to the Top's Common Core and Common Core State Standards and Associated High Stakes Tests, Partnership for Assessment and Readiness for College and Career, PARC, and Smarter Balance, which other states have adopted, have emerged as the most expansive effort to implement market-based reforms on a national level using the pretext of educational equity. And of course, the need to develop the workforce for the 21st century economy. You hear that a lot. Accordingly, Common Core Standards is tailored towards the core curriculum based on the industry-driven fields of science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. Designed and imposed by corporate foundations, corporations, think tanks, and private trade organizations working in partnership with federal and state governments, Common Core and PARC are achieving several key corporate education reform goals that have been in the works for decades, as I'll talk about. And this includes national standardized curriculum linked to high-stakes tests that stimulate privatization, de-skilling, and union busting, while furthering the transformation of education by public good, is the central site of contestation. That's why we have the importance of universal public space and public schools, especially into profitable market segments, transferring more public money into private hands, and dominating those markets by corporate entities that are profitable immensely. So I think important questions to ask within that framework, all of this framework is the different ways in which the school curriculum and assessment systems are organized and the political and social agendas that accompany them. We must always consider that, which have profound consequences for students' learning, teachers' work, and the priorities within our society. What and who shapes school curriculum? Because it involves the inclusion and exclusion of certain kinds of knowledge and ways of knowing and worldviews. And who defines the role and function of our education system are essential considerations for any of us who want to live in a just and equitable society. And just so quickly, can I just say that a lot of who's been driving this, and this is just a short list, there's more, but it's U.S. Chamber of Commerce, Business Roundtable, corporations like Intel, Target, Cisco, IBM, Goldman Sachs, AT&T, Exxon, Pearson, of course, the world's largest education company, Grove Foundation, billionaire insurance tycoon Eli Grove, Gates Foundation, you know them, Walton Foundation, which is the Walmart family, and at an education investors gathering in 2012, the reporter who was there covering it, I'm going to read from that. The K-12 market is tantalizing and huge. The U.S. spends more than $500 billion a year to educate kids from ages 5 to 18. The entire education sector represents nearly 9% of U.S. gross domestic product, more than the energy or technology sectors. Investors are optimistic that a golden moment has arrived. They're pouring private equity and venture capital into scores of companies that aim to profit by taking over broad swaths of public education. It's already done.
I hope my voice is going to do it for you. Wave your hand every once in a while, and it'll remind me I need to speak up, okay?
There's spots up front, too, if people are having a hard time hearing.
My name is Pixie Holbrook, and I was invited here as a historian in the opposition to exactly what he articulated. I'm currently working in Northampton part-time. I'm the mentor coordinator here, training mentors, and I also work part-time as a reading teacher as well. And I have my boss looking at me.
He's here too.
All right, so I'm going to talk to you about the resistance that we responded to back in starting in 1999. And it started with public forums, not unlike this, but it became more legitimized by the work done by CARE and FairTest. CARE was Coalition for Authentic Reform in Education. I think FairTest is still a viable group, out east. They were an extraordinary group of advocates, educators, people like Alfie Cohn and Deborah Myers, Jonathan Kozel, Monty Neal, Ruth Kaplan, who is now Board of Education. And so I think where we first got in touch with it here was a group got together inspired by their work and created a forum in Petsmith Town. And I attended and I fully committed by the end of the meeting. So our common concerns, and you have to bear with me, I went through a stack of material last few weeks looking over what we had done. But the common concerns were that MCAS high stakes testing violated the 1993 Ed Reform Law, which called for a variety of assessment instruments, which clearly would be overriding. We felt that high stakes testing was not synonymous with high standards and school improvement. We felt that it narrowed and restricted curriculum to a bunch of facts. Curriculum, which is an out-of-home term. Instruction should address diverse interests and learning styles, which doesn't happen. We asked ourselves, is MCAS really a useful diagnostic tool? We were told we could use it. We felt that MCAS hurt kids. It hurt kids who have special needs, children with second language, the stress of passing, and of failure. a diploma should never be measured on one kind of measurement. It can't be determined, because remember, this was all new. This was all new. So we were hearing for the first time that a test was going to determine graduation. We felt that teaching to the MCAS undermined learning and thus lowered the standards. We felt that it hurt schools and demoralized the teachers. This was 14 years ago. We felt there were other sound ways to raise standards and hold schools accountable for the education of all students. And we knew that there were a lot of politics surrounding the MCAS. They were extremely questionable, that real education had been hijacked by the administrative policies. We felt that the MCAS was going to start forcing the teachers to teach to the test, therefore dumbing down the curriculum. We felt that the MCAS was going to burden teachers and students with an extremely long test regimen. It was actually longer than the Massachusetts bar exam. Using 18 to 20 hours of wasting time. We felt that it devalued the technical, linguistic, musical, athletic, and vocational skills of our students. And it was certainly going to introduce new obstacles to children who are already today. We knew how our students were doing. They were telling us this was ways to find out how are your students doing. We already knew. All we had to do was look at the zip code. We knew how our students were doing. And if we wanted to know who needed improvement, who needed the best teachers, who needed the smallest class size, who needed the best budgets, look at the picture. It was not a test of basic skills. We kept hearing that. Oh, it's just a test of basic skills. But there had been no body, no group of people that had ever determined what are those basic skills before graduation. So we knew that the MCAS was going to create a wider gap between the haves and the have-nots, and that it immediately discriminated against private and parochial students who were going to be exempt from the MCAS. We knew very clearly, as Tim so well explained to us just now, that corporate America had a lot to gain by the profit of just the tests alone, from dismantling the public schools in favor of for-profit charter schools and the voucher system. And then upon digging behind every form, we certainly could learn that corporations had already locked in a lot of big money under the guidance that it's done silver and way well. education as a business model was beginning to form. This is newer language for all of us. Students were being trained to produce, be workers for corporations, and clearly teachers wouldn't know how to do that, was their thinking. And then they further hid under the banner of, oh, it's not just about schools, it's about how they reform urban schools, which is what our formulation is. And clearly, educators were no longer going to be evaluating the students. We weren't thinking about that. So the curriculum framework, that was our first line, was developed very inappropriately. Much of it was developed by James Kaiser, who was then the head of our Board of Education, a non-educator. He was the head of the Pioneer Institute, which was a conservative education think tank. And in fact, the Board of Ed at that time was made up of none were educators. Five of the nine were associated with the Pioneer Institute. MCAS was an unfunded mandate that we knew was going to suck away dollars that could pay for teachers and staff and art and music and field trips and library books and librarians. And the test was just too hard. At one point, when we first saw it, we brought it to an Amherst professor, and he said that some of the material at the social studies level particularly rivaled what AP freshmen at Amherst College were going to expect to finish. It was going to fail students, and it was going to help justify the charter school movement, taking more dollars away than the child got together. Our mantra was, it's too long, it's too hard, it's too expensive, it's too important. So those are the common compelling reasons for us to get involved. Social injustice is everything. So what we started off with was, again, public forums, again, similar to this. And we created a sort of a local group that were people from Northampton, Amherst, Pittsfield, Springfield, Hampshire Regional, Long Meadow. And from that, there was a tight group of us local leaders, affectionately known as the Wild Women of Western Massachusetts. There is one member here besides me, who's standing in the back. And one was a principal, a high school student, a middle school student. I was there as a special educator. And an elementary school student who was the Massachusetts teacher the year before, Mary Grimley. So we traveled to Boston a lot to check out with fair testing care. But after a while, we kind of went, we were independent, exchanging information, and they provided, I think, some things to manage, really good, powerful written material that we would use. We would go to PTO meetings, we would go to STEDCAC, the Parent Advisory Council, we went to Girls Club and to Springfield, creating fact sheets, petitions to the Board of Ed, to the Department of Ed, and legislators. We left them where we could, Dennis' office and houses of our relatives. We created bumper stickers and we had, but it allowed us to have people come to us and say, what's MCAS? And we could start that conversation. Because again, no one had experience in MCAS. This was all being produced and getting some idea of what was coming. It wasn't in practice yet. It was kind of surreal. No one was relating to it. So the buy-in to opposing it, was kind of slow. Parents and even educators were just sort of too busy, too distracted. Legislators didn't fully grasp what was headed their way. So at the forums, we did a lot to point out that they weren't basic skills. We emphasized that it was really heading towards a shallow understanding of it than the meaningful information. The one I love to tell people was the example on the social studies test, which was an illustration of the empire of the continent of Africa with four locations. And the question was, where was the empire of Mali in the 1400s? Okay? So my first reaction is, pardon me, who cares? The second is, I need to teach my children how to go get that information. That might be really vital to a bigger story and to a bigger problem. So my job as an educator is not to stuff all these little back trivia into the brain, but that's the MCAS disaster. We also emphasized how every state was creating a new test. They weren't even standardized. We didn't even know what the typical third grader did, the typical 10th grader did. When you compare it to like the Florida FCAT, an eighth grade question in the Florida FCAT was very different than ours. There was one that asked the question, which state is a series of islands? That was an eighth grade question, it was. So the answer was crazy, and Massachusetts was one of the hardest questions. We visited local school committees, we urged their support. We had letter writing campaigns to legislators. After the first year, when people started to take the test, we started to notice more. Now back then, it was only fourth, eighth, and tenth grade. And kids were coming home, parents were starting to talk, children were getting sick. We were bribing them with gum and treats and extra recess, and the wild men got angrier, and we fought a little harder. And people started to write really powerful letters to the editors, so that was helpful. Our beautiful Mayor Gidney wrote a very, very powerful letter that some of you know has gone viral, because it just speaks so deeply to what we want to say to our students. And I think Jenny will share some of that letter, or all that letter, because it's being used at Fashion Street. We also went into the streets. We believe the street theater makes people pay attention. We did take the test, and we set up right on Main Street in a couple of the cities, and we asked passersby to come and take the test just to experience it. It was very revealing. We actually, at one point, asked Stan Rosenberg to take the test. And he had said to us that it's a test of basic skills, and why are they so upset? Just basic skills. So we said, Stan, would you just take it, you know, and we don't even want to hear how you did, we're not going to score it, just take it privately, and you know, we consistently pushed him. And he finally said to me, he said, oh, I haven't been in school for like 18 years, I won't do very well on it. I said, Stan, you said it was a test of basic skills. I certainly hope you're using your basic skills as my legislator. We didn't talk much about it.
We've all had that experience.
I don't stand funny. We invited Alfred Cohen out here. We had a big gathering hosted at one of the We did one. So what I want to say though is that the bad news is we didn't do enough. I'd love to tell you I made a big impact. We walked away saying the best thing that came out of it was this very keen friendship that we all have. But I have to believe that the Common Core is going to galvanize more attention. We tried opting out. We had parents, not very many, who boycotted. Their students got a zero. If two boycotted, that was 2 zeros. And a school got a lower score. And then the threat started, which is your scores are going to equal less money. One teacher tried to boycott doing it. You know, his job was in jeopardy. He stopped. So the boycotts couldn't get off the ground. Disenfranchised families couldn't participate. And families that knew a lot about education, who cared a lot about schools, were proud of the kids' school. They were walking around saying, oh my goodness, you finally set some high standards. So the boycotts just did not happen for us. But I do believe it's a different feel because it's natural, there's more of us. So I have to end by hoping that we can all do this work again. Thank you.
Hi everybody, I'm Dustin Morales. The first thing I want to say is that a few years ago, actually it was more than a few years ago, I don't want to be specific about the dates of who I was with, just I want you to get the understanding. So I was in a meeting, and I was in a meeting with some higher-ups and a principal. And one of the higher-ups said, wow, you have some really good teachers in this school. And my principal was caught off guard by this statement. And he goes, how do you know? He goes, because you're at that school. And I mean, I've always been against a lot of this nonsense, but it really solidified a point for me that one of the biggest problems that we're facing is this identity of tests and doing well on tests with being productive and being a good person and being a good teacher. And we really have to move away from that. And the most personal thing I'm going to tell you right now is that had this been the culture of schools when I was growing up, I would have dropped out. I have no doubt about that. I can't stand it as a teacher, and as a youngster, I was really rebellious, if you can imagine that. So I don't think I would have made it through the school where there was no art, no music, no anything. I did a lot of woodworking when I was in school. I did a lot of home ec. You know, we had shops to go to. So that broke up my day and it helped me out a lot. The first thing we need to talk about when we talk about high stakes testing is, yes, it started out earlier, but I'm talking about in the more contemporary experience right now. We have to talk about Arne Duncan. And the reason we have to talk about Arne Duncan is because he has 0 years teaching experience in education. Now this is the person in charge of the Department of Education, which I see as hugely problematic. When you have somebody in charge of an industry that they have nothing to do with, and they've never had anything to do with. The high stakes testing and its effect on teachers is very widespread. So because of my status, and if you don't know anything about me, I'm sure you'll find out as we go along. But because of my status and this past year and the things that I've done, I've had a chance to talk to a lot of people across the country. I've gotten to speak at several places and really started to get an idea that it's not just in Massachusetts. Because for a long time, when I first started advocating for my students and the idea of how bad high-stakes testing is, especially for struggling students, and in Holyoke, we have a lot of struggling students. And you're talking about cities that are predominantly Black and Latino, and they're being targeted the most. So I'm getting this sense, now that I'm speaking with people from across the country, that this is not isolated to Massachusetts. This is happening in the entire country. I've got emails from teachers who are talking about just leaving the profession altogether. Now, you would think that somebody who's 22, 23 years old would not have that kind of taste in their mouth from teaching, but that's the case. And just in my building last year, we have two teachers who were close to retirement, I would say 1 or 2 years, and they took a 20% cut in retirement just to get out. So I'm building up the context to explain what high stakes testing is doing to the profession in general. And you have people that try to take one apart from the other. So they say what's good for the students on this side and what's good for the teachers on this side. And that's nonsense. If you've ever been in a classroom, what's good for the teacher is good for the student. And so when you build an environment, and high-stakes testing has a huge part to do with it, when you build an environment around high-stakes testing that affects the teacher negatively, it affects the student negatively. If you have children of your own, you know that when you're anxious, they feel your anxiety. It's the same thing with teachers. When the teacher feels anxious, there's that power of transference that passes from the teacher to the student, and you don't have any productivity. The teacher can't do their best work when they're feeling stressed out all the time. We're seeing an attrition rate that was already bad, because teaching has always been a difficult endeavor. Don't let anybody tell you that it's always been a difficult endeavor. They have just made it into a miserable endeavor, and that's the big difference. So even when I first started teaching, and I'm a youngster compared to a lot of the people who've been teaching, I'm only in my ninth year, and just from what I've seen in 2005 to now is a nightmare. I can't even believe it's happening. 2005, when the standards were really being pushed and MCAS was really starting to be pushed, I think the first class to have passed it was 2003. So I was in that frame where people were really focusing on the scores. Like, it started becoming really relevant. But I caught it early on in 2005, where it wasn't the huge thing that it is now. And then as I started teaching and my career kept going, I started noticing just how bad. I started seeing teachers walk out of buildings having anxiety attacks just and leaving. Not coming back. I'm talking about walking out and that's it. I'm not doing this anymore. And a lot of people have a hard time even believing it and even more so understanding it. If you don't understand how much of an impact high stakes testing is having, all you have to do is look at the curricula from across the state, especially with charter schools. It happens in public schools too, but especially with charter schools. There are curricula available online. You can search this yourself. And you will see in that 40-week span, you'll see anywhere between 2 to 6 weeks devoted to MCAS prep. And they don't call it anything else, they call it MCAS prep, where they teach them how to fill in the correct bubbles, how to identify which answers are the correct ones. That's not a real skill. I'm willing to have that argument, that debate with anybody who tells me that filling in the correct bubbles is an actual skill. Thinking critically and thinking about your environment, thinking about the observations that you're making, and thinking about your thinking, that's a skill. That's something I love teaching my students. I never take part in MCAS prep as a principal. I just cannot imagine having spent all this time becoming an educator, becoming a teacher, and wanting to do it since the time I was a child, to then spend my adult life brainwashing children to take a test that means absolutely nothing in the long run. And I think that's the big message that we need to take away from today, is that what does it mean in the long run? And it means absolutely nothing. Look at all the people who've done really well in the MCAS, and they are... You're seeing them on the same exact tracks that kids were on prior to the MCAT. Maybe actually worse. The research that I'm primarily focusing on for me in high stakes testing is that since the implementation of MCAT, you start to see this drop off of minority populations specifically. So they weren't great. I'm not advocating for that at all. I'm not saying public education has always been the best thing in the world. I'm saying we actually made it worse with high stakes testing. So you see the minority population drop off. And it's not just with the students. High stakes testing affects the teachers, because before MCAS came along, we had a thing called the MCELs. And I don't know if any of you remember a time before the MCELs, but there was a time in this state where you didn't have to take that ridiculous teacher test to become a teacher. And I can't even imagine how many good teachers we lose because they can't pass the test, and the test is a really terrible failure. But also, with the MTEL, you see a decline with the minority populations due to the testing. As soon as the test is implemented, you see the drop off. So that's where my research is focusing. And I really want people to think about that in the big picture and in the broad perspective of what is it we're getting out of these high stakes testing and who is it actually affecting? Because what we see in my city, in Holyoke, and we broke it down statistically. We mapped out all the MCAS scores, and we mapped out all the socioeconomic status of all the kids. And it's clear as day. If you didn't believe it before, there's no reason for you not to believe it now. So you have the kids, and as their socioeconomic status goes up in the district, their MCAS scores follow. The kids who live in poor, impoverished environments are down here. The kids who live in the affluent suburbs are up here. So all we're doing by wasting money on testing is telling us what we already know, that kids living in poverty are suffering on multiple levels. And we refuse to address it. We instead focus on blaming the teachers. And the idea of high-stakes testing for me is absolutely insulting because I grew up in Holyoke and I went to Holyoke Public Schools. And I loved it. It was a great experience for me. But what high-stakes testing, MCAS, and everything that's come after it says is if you're not putting objective standards, agendas on your board, you're not an effective teacher. If you can't put together a binder, you're not an effective teacher. And it all has to do with the high-stakes test. Because at some point in the very near future, they're going to tie the teacher evaluations to how students perform on tests. Now, that's also problematic because I've had students tell me directly that they play the abracadabra game on testing. And if you don't know the abracadabra game, it means they see who finishes the first and who makes the best design on their sheets. My livelihood being attached to that is going to add a layer of stress and anxiety to my life that is not sustainable, and you're going to see more teachers dropping off. So this is what I'm talking about when I say that you can't take students and teachers and put them in two different categories. We have to treat one as one group, that when we create a bad environment for the students, you are in turn creating a bad environment for the teachers. And when you create a bad environment for the teachers, you are in turn creating a bad environment for the students to learn it. Barbara Mataloni, who's the president of the MTA, says it best. It's a very simple phrase. Teachers' working conditions are students' learning conditions. And we have to really think about that and how we treat the teachers and the buildings that they work in, because when you have one building that has AC and then you have another building that does not have AC, that's a huge disparity between the two buildings. You have kids who are going to sweat through 3 or 4 months of the year, and you have kids who are going to be very comfortable. And then when you go from city to city, all of a sudden you see the disparity. I mean, take Holyoke, for example, my beautiful city that I love through and through. But you take Holyoke, and I've been to other cities, and I've worked with people from other cities, and I look at our resources versus other cities, and it's heartbreaking to me. We don't have a tax base. So because we don't have a tax base, our kids suffer for it. They don't get any real good technology. They don't get any real good extracurricular activities. And then the ones that are available to them have to do with money. And obviously, kids who are living in impoverished areas don't have access to money. And what all this has to do with high-stakes testing is we keep ignoring the real issue. And the real issue is not how the kids are performing on the test. I could have told you that without ever having them take the test. So that's just something for us to think about as a group. And when we break up into our group, the idea of where the high-stakes tests are coming from, the billionaires, and where we, what we intend to get out of these high-stakes tests. Thank you.
Jen Lee, who's a kindergarten teacher at Jackson State School, is going to read a letter that is sent out by Jackson State School along with the scores.
So the letter starts off just with some sort of encouragement you'll find Massachusetts comprehensive assessment system scores for your child, and some little details about that. And then it goes on to say, parents and guardians, it's up to you whether or not you want to share these results with your children. If you decide to, I would appreciate it if you could read or let your children read what I have written below. I would be happy to discuss this aspect of the test and the sharing of the results with your life. Dear fourth graders, there are many ways of being smart, and there are many different ways to assess, to find out about what children know and what they can do. The MCAS is just one way that the state of Massachusetts is trying out. We know that it is not the only way to find out what children can do and what they know. If you did well on this test, I'm happy for you and congratulate you for your effort. If you didn't do as well as you had hoped, then I do not want you to worry. There are many more chances to take these tests in your future school years. And really, I want everyone to remember this. We are concerned that these tests do not always assess all of what it is that makes each of you special and unique. The people who devise these tests and score them do not know each of you the way your teachers do, the way I do, the way your families do. They do not know that many of you can speak two languages. They do not know that you can play the violin or the piano, or that you can take dance or paint a picture. They do not know that you sometimes take care of your little brother or sister after school, that your friends count on you to be there for them, and that your laughter can brighten the dreary day. They do not know that you write poetry, play soccer, wonder about black holes, and know exactly how much change you should get when you go to the market. They do not know that you go to shed with your mom, or that you grow vegetables and flowers with your dad or your grandparent in the summer. They do not know that you are trustworthy, that you are kind, that you are thoughtful, and that you try every day to do your very best. In fact, they do not know you at all, but we know you. Your moms, your dads, your grandparents, teachers, principals, your neighbors, and your friends love you and are proud of all that you are and all that you will be. The scores you get will tell you something, but they will not tell you everything. There are many ways of being smart. Your principal, so glad that I am.
So there was a study recently released within this past year. There was 123,000 college students, and it was over 3 years at 33 colleges and universities. And what it found out was what teachers have known for a long time, that GPA was a much better indicator of student success than any standardized test. Mm-hmm. Now this was a study, and like I just read off to you, that huge study, 123,000 students in over 3 years. And no standardized test score can measure up to a teacher's analysis of a student because we combine how they do academically, but we also combine their participation, how they are interacting, you know, with other students, how timely they are with their projects and assignments. All that builds into the GPA, and it's a much better assessment or a way to analyze a student than any standardized test score. Just wanted to put that out there.
Okay, so as usual, and these are these sort of issues that are complicated, and we try to talk about them, we are running behind. So, we're gonna, if we can move, after when I say go, if we could move as quickly as possible into small groups at these tables, the idea is we'll be down to about 15 or 20 minutes, to sort of hash out maybe some questions, clarifications, opinions, concerns in these small groups, and then we're gonna come back with maybe some clarification gained or not, or more questions, to present some of these questions to the panel for the last little bit of the day. So if you could go into that.
There's also water and drinking problems in here.
Hi, everybody. We are reconvening. I have pretty loud voice. I've never needed a microphone in my life.
Thank you for coming back after the small groups. I needed to interrupt those conversations because it looked like they were going really well. But I wanted to give the group the opportunity to address the panel again, either about things that they talked about or questions that arose in your small groups after the testimonials. I wanted to say thank you to all of the people who gave the work. And I'm also wondering if you wouldn't mind staying an extra 5 minutes to 8:35 so we can get a full 15 minutes.
Thanks for your presentation. It's been very inspiring. And I just wanted to ask, what kind of power do you feel like parents can leverage? And what do you see happening in terms of how parents are opting out or doesn't go to school, so you know, writing letters together, what kind of leverage do you recommend?
I think parents are the ultimate authority. And it's not just me saying that, it's the Constitution of the United States. You have the ultimate right in your child's education, their upbringing, and all that stuff. And I've been talking to a lot of people across Massachusetts, and we're thinking of instead of calling it opting out, because we're putting together a template letter. It's a refusal. Refusals, there's nothing legally anybody can do about a refusal. You can refuse anything in this world. That's your prerogative as a human being. So we already have a template for that. And like I said, parents are the ultimate authority, and you guys, really the power rests with you guys in the sense that, as a teacher, so I paid the ultimate price. I got fired for speaking out. And I'm okay with that. I can live with that because I can look at myself in the mirror. But I don't have the same kind of power that a parent does. A parent who has a child in the school and can make a lot of noise and constant noise. And maybe not just one parent, but you guys already have a group here. You get multiple parents to show up at a school committee meeting and start just asking questions. You don't have to be defiant. You don't have to be crazy. Just ask some general questions. How much time in my child's day is being devoted to testing of some sort? Because they'll say MCAS is only this many days or this many days, but they're not giving you the full answer. Because in my district in Holyoke, it ends up being 27 to 35 days spent on testing. Now, I want you to think about that. 27 to 35 days, your child sitting in a room, just like out of their mind. And this is why I said, this is why I opened up my presentation by saying that I would have dropped out. I can't sit still for that long. I had a hard time with this presentation. That's it for me.
I just want to add that one of the things that came up were the parents that did opt out to don't say, I'll keep my kid home. You have to say, and you will provide alternative educational opportunities to my child who will not be in the room for me.
And it's in the template, and I'll make sure anybody can get it.
No. Do you want to talk
about that? I just wanted to say the MTA just came out with some legal information. You were on the whole process of refusal. And one thing that would help is if we would get our school committees to create a mechanism for that. The teachers have to legally give the test under state law, but the school committee can create a mechanism so that they will provide an alternate. So we could kind of go in and put pressure on our school committees to create that mechanism. So that's what we're trying to do.
Someone said that actually if you get past a certain number, you refuse it, then the test is not valid.
Anyways, it has to do with stats, and once you hit a certain percentage, which I believe is 9%, it becomes everything for 5 or 6%. It becomes invalidated. The results can't be.
Right. So it seems like that you have to get a critical mass, because what we're always threatened with is, oh my God, if only 5 kids get zeros, then that's going to drop you to a level 3 school. So, if you had 50 refusals, then they'd say, oh, well, then the tests aren't valid.
And I also want to point out that you guys are not alone, and I don't know how many of you are social media savvy, and that's okay if you're not. But there are groups out there. There's a Network for Public Education. There's United Opt Out, headed by Peggy Robinson. She's fabulous, and she's trying to put opt out in the entire country, not just in Colorado where she's from. And there's also the most awesome group of all. And the group is called Badass Teachers, but don't be fooled. We have parents in there, two of the greatest parent advocates in this country right now, both reside in Chicago. And both are members of Badass Teachers and call themselves Bats. It's a fabulous group. It's a good place to learn about these kinds of things and what's going on in other places. Because the worst thing we can do is localize our problem. We need to think on a much bigger scale and know that this is happening all across the country. It's not just us.
Also, there are a few of us that there are a few of us that got together last year to opt to our
sign up to start.
What, and what, the stats?
Yeah. No. keep that since Northampton and the Collective Action Coalition.
I put flyers and little postcards about masks.
So everything.
And everything has a discussion about the semantics of preservation, that we use that word a lot for that a lot, what we really say and use that word. And we had a definition thrown out that's sort of more what we're really talking about. We're talking about preservation, like the transfer of money from public hands to private hands or public hands.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's just an important piece of this to really clarify. Like you're talking about private school, or you're talking about public money, then you're going to, you know, for-profit companies. And I don't know if you want to read it, but
we're funneling the system now, funnels public money to manage public schools for the profit of private companies.
This is a big thing, and I think it helps us kind of understand this better even leaner if we step back from public education. Because remember, the context is that what's happening in public schools is also happening throughout our economy. The shift, right, from the public sector to everything being oriented to the private sector. And I think, you know, there's terms for that. We throw out these general terms, null terms, free market. Oftentimes it's something that's more of an academic term in this country, but more popular in other countries is neoliberalism, which is based on liberal economics, which is Adam Smith's free market capitalism. But the dupe is with neoliberalism is that public monies largely fund private profit in many, many ways, insidious ways, sometimes very directly, sometimes more indirectly, tax breaks and other things, right? And the terms that we often know from outside of public education is called outsourcing. And so when we outsource our services, I work at UMass Amherst, and it's happening, this is part and parcel of everything we're talking about, this larger picture, is that you outsource public services or components of it to be privately managed and operated. And that's what's happening here. And there is this, and that goes against free market capitalism. But it's still capitalism. In fact, many people, you know, going back, have called it state capitalism as well. It's also the term that that's more contemporary, even in the mainstream in business, is public-private partnerships. So, and when you hear that, beware, because that we're talking about, well, that's nice for partnering, you know? It's a win-win. No, it's a lose-win, right? Public win, loses, you know, private shareholders benefit. So I think that, and then also another term is quasi-public, right? And but certainly charter schools are not public. I'm sick of hearing that name. Many of us are. It's not true.
I think that in our group we've had conversations how we can fight back that we didn't really, you know, kind of get through, but I think it's, you know, looking at Barbara's election as the head of the MTA, I think it's, you know, it's kind of when we're envisioning what can a teacher's union look like or what can a union look like, I think, you know, there's a couple of different examples. You know, CCU in Chicago, I think, is a great example. Very difficult to pull off a statewide strike here, even though I think it still works fine. But the Massachusetts Nurses Association has 1/8 the membership of the MTA. And while there's some really unfortunate trends in healthcare that are damaging to nurses, legislatively in Boston, the MNA has won one victory after the other, right? And it's done by having an engaged membership. It's done by challenging the Democratic Party, kowtowing to the Democratic Party, but by challenging. And their most recent victory was by going directly to voters and then negotiating a deal where they were able to successfully put now Massachusetts and California, I believe, are the only two states that have any kind of limitation on nurse staffing levels in hospitals, and it's only in intensive care units, but it's a major difference for the union, a major step forward. And I really think that it's how, you know, legislatively, how teachers can look going forward. The reason why the foundation budget has been, you know, cut so to the bone is because of a 1998 ballot initiative, which was endorsed by the League of Women Voters, among other people, which eliminated Massachusetts' tax on unearned income. Massachusetts used to have one of the highest taxes on unearned income in the country, a tax on capital gains, and it was eliminated. And I think in 2016, Massachusetts, you could have a lot of different things in one ballot initiative, and I say, why don't we start bringing back the tax on unearned income in the state, the tax on dividends and interest. It only affects 2% of the state's households. And then using that, you can say this money cannot go to school districts that do not have an elected school board in the process. This money cannot go to school districts that spend more than a certain percentage of their money on private schools or on tests. This money cannot go to school districts that are in violation of international labor organization standards on public sector unionization. And I really think that that's what the nurses did, and that's what people are going to earn sick time and vote yes on the question for. And I think that's the type of thing.
Can I make a quick point?
Yeah.
Yeah. Money and public schools, for me, I never want to hear the two in the same sentence unless you're talking about giving me more. That's basically my bottom line with privatization, whatever you want to call it. It's irrelevant to me what terminology we use. For me, it's all about the actions that some charter schools are taking. And while there is a very, very, very small percentage of the charter schools that are mostly public, they're the rarity. They're the rarity, and they don't exist for the most part in the state. You know, we're talking about one in Louisiana that I heard about, and another one in New Mexico. But other than that, I haven't heard of any other ones that operate with such transparency. And that's the big problem with public school versus charter. We're super transparent. We have to be. Legally, we're bound to the public. Charter schools, not so much. We don't know how much money they pull in. We don't know how many students they're dishing out or taking in. It's all, you know, fancy sidestepping.
So thank you so much to the panelists, and thank you all for coming. We don't want to end here. We do want to say that PSAC is going to be sponsoring more events throughout the fall and winter. We hope to be hosting some film screenings on different issues, and then having discussions after those film screenings. You can also, as I said, join the listserv, get involved in our organizing group, and you can talk more about how to resist crisis testing or about the other issues we're working on in our group, and then there's other literature.